God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. Let us say together the Gloria. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, Heavenly King, Almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy upon us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Grant us, Lord, not to be anxious about earthly things, but to love things heavenly. And even now, while we are placed among things that are passing away, to hold fast to those that shall endure. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Amen. Please be seated for the readings.
A reading from Jeremiah, chapter 11, verses 18 through 20. It was the Lord who made it known to me, and I heard. Then you showed me that you will teach. But I was like a gentle lamb led to the slaughter, and I did not know it was against me that they devised schemes, saying, let us destroy the tree with its fruit. Let us cut him off from the land of the living, so that his name will no longer be. But you, O Lord of hosts, who judge righteously, who try the heart and the mind, let me see your retribution upon them, for to you I have committed my cause. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The psalm today is Psalm 54. Let us read the entire thing in unison.
Save me, O God, by hearing me. In your might, defend my cause. Hear my prayer, O God. Give ear to the words of my mouth. For the arrogant have risen up against me, and ruleth as he sought my life. Those who have no regard for God. Behold, God is my helper. It is the Lord who sustains my life. Render evil to those who spy on me. In your faithfulness, destroy them. I will offer you a freewill sacrifice and praise your name, O Lord, for it is good. For you have rescued me from every trouble, and my eye has seen the ruin of my foes.
Reading from the letter of James, verses 13 through chapter 3, verses 13 through chapter 4, and what a reason to mourn. Who is wise and understanding among you? Show by your good life that your works are done with gentleness born of wisdom. But if you have bitter envy and selfish ambition in your hearts, do not be boastful and false to the truth. Such wisdom does not come down from above, but is earthly, unspiritual, devilish. For where there is envy and selfish ambition, there will also be disorder and wickedness of every kind. But the wisdom from above is first pure and peaceable, gentle, willing to yield, full of mercy and good fruits, without a trace of partiality or hypocrisy. And the harvest of righteousness is sown in peace for those who tend to make peace. Those conflicts and disputes among you, where do they come from? Do they not come from your cravings that are born within you? You want something and you do not have it. So you commit murder, and you covet something and you cannot obtain it. So you engage in disputes and conflicts. You do not have because you do not lose. You ask and do not receive because you ask wrongly in order to spend what you get on your pleasure. Submit yourself, therefore, to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Draw to God, and he will draw near to you. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Mark. Jesus and his disciples passed through Galilee. He didn't want anyone to know it, for he was teaching his disciples, saying to them, "The Son of Man is to be betrayed into human hands, and they will kill him. And 3 days after being killed, he will rise again." But they didn't understand what he was saying and were afraid to ask him. Then they came to Capernaum, and when he was in the house, he asked them, "What were you arguing about on the way?" But they were silent, for on the way they had argued with one another who was the greatest. He sat down, called the 12, and said to them, "Whoever wants to be first must be last of all and servant of all." Then he took a little child and put it among them, and taking it in his arms, he said to them, "Whoever welcomes one such child in my name welcomes me, and whoever welcomes me welcomes not me, but the one who sent me. The Gospel of the Lord. I want to invite the children, you guys up to coming over for a minute? Come down with me. It's tough when there are only two or three of you. Yeah, little guy. Come on down, you guys, for a minute. I told the 8 o'clock folks they were missing out because they didn't get to do this with us. And so I had to kind of fill them in a little bit about what we were doing. How are you guys this morning? Are you good? So Jesus taught us often using a story called a parable. Have you ever heard that word before? No. Parable. And a parable is a special kind of a story. It's a story that doesn't really have a clear ending, you know? It kind of leaves things a little bit open for us to wonder about or to think about. And many of the parables Jesus told were about the kingdom of God. So if I say kingdom to you, what do you guys think of? What comes to mind when you say your kingdom?
Rome.
Yeah. What else? A what, sweetie? Like a city, like a place. Okay, we think about a place. What else? What do you think about with kingdom?
A ruler over
other people. Right? Yeah, you too. I know. Do you think about kind of like jewels and, right? You know, a kingdom, right? Kind of those sorts of things. Do you think about that? Yeah, sometimes I do too. And you know, Jesus taught about the kingdom of God, and it's a really different kind of kingdom. And the stories he told us helped us see that. So one of the stories Jesus told was about the kingdom of God being like a mustard seed. A mustard seed. I have some mustard seeds right here. Would you like to hold one? These are mustard seeds from Palestine. And Jesus said, why don't you put out your finger? Because it's going to take one tiny finger. Jesus said, the kingdom of God is like a mustard seed. You ready? What do you think about that?
It's so small.
Look at that. And in the parable Jesus tells, he says, the kingdom of God is like a mustard seed that becomes like the biggest shrub, a big tree kind of a shrub that all the birds can nest in. Isn't that amazing?
Yeah. Why is it so small?
Is it a big fancy seed? What does it look like? What does it remind you of? Anything? Like a teeny tiny little pebble, maybe a grain of sand kind of thing. Yeah. Yeah. It's a miracle, isn't it? To think about that could grow into a huge, big brush. But that's what the kingdom of God's all about, isn't it? It's about small. It's about simple. It's about a very different kind of kingdom. So Jesus left us room to wonder, didn't he? We can kind of wonder what kind of kingdom that is. And as we read the Bible and as we listen to Jesus's words, we're going to think about that more and more, okay? Will you guys think about that with me?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah. You going to hang on to your seed?
Probably.
They're so tiny, aren't they? Yeah. Okay, you guys, thank you. Thanks for coming up. You guys go back. The kingdom of God is like. For those of us lucky enough to have grown up in a tradition where we got to hear the stories of Jesus over and over again, and that is not everyone anymore. For those of us lucky enough to have grown up in a tradition with regular doses of Bible stories, we know some of these parables, don't we? The kingdom of God is like that tiny mustard seed. There's another one that says the kingdom of God is like a precious pearl that once someone finds, they'll sell everything they own to have that pearl. the other, there's another one that's about a man who finds a treasure buried in a field, and he goes and he gives away everything he has to raise enough money to buy that field. Yet, if we were to ask one another, just as the kids and I explored, what we mean by kingdom in our world today, we probably would come up with a very different list of words. Saying kingdom, we wouldn't come up with tiny seed, precious pearl, treasure hidden in a field. A lot more likely, we would think about the new cover of the Time magazine and reflect on the thousands of dollars of jewelry being worn by the royal family when they're photographed. We might think about houses, big houses, lots of houses, possessions, wealth, privilege, and all the power that comes with that. And honestly, we wouldn't be too far off the notions of first century Palestine's idea of kingdom as well. Yet in first century Palestine, historians tell us, there was a sense of class that went even beyond what we imagine. There was a scale there that we'd have a hard time imagining, because in first century Palestine, there was no middle class. Most of the wealth had accumulated at the very top of the social structure, and the vast majority of everybody else was profoundly poor. Within the elite world of the first century, honor was incredibly important. The rich wanted to associate only with the rich, and they would intentionally insult or demean those who were slightly less rich to accumulate favor with those a little further up. Children were quite literally the possessions of their fathers. They had no rights, they had no value until they were old enough to begin to bring value to the family, either by being sold into marriage or by working and bringing wealth into the house that way. Under Pax Romana, or the Peace of Rome, the upper class were actively cultivated to serve as client rulers on behalf of the emperor. Agrarian peasants living at barely subsistence level often found themselves having to sell their children or other household members to pay debts to survive an especially bad growing season or a bad year. The very poor, among whom New Testament scholarship tell us that the Gospel of Mark likely circulated, was the village culture of Palestine. Having a little bit of that context helps us see how incredibly disruptive and radical Jesus's words were. Because to us today, it doesn't seem very radical to bring a child into our midst, does it? It was a deeply patriarchal system in which those on top regularly shamed those on the bottom to maintain their honor and their position. And in a world where there were very few possessions held by most, who you were or who others saw you to be mattered enormously. And here Jesus comes and he sits down in the position of a teacher and he teaches. And he says that one must be the servant of all. To be great, we must be lowly. And in doing so, he challenges the very system under which everyone lives. You might even today hear the words of the protesters in our streets just miles away saying, "Why does it have to be this way?" And here's Jesus responding, "It doesn't have to be. And one day in Parousia, it won't be." And to illustrate this deeply controversial notion of power resting in the poor and dispossessed, Jesus gathers up into his arms a child, a being, a person who has no identity nor any possessions of its own. To honor Jesus, we must bring into our hearts those whom society values the least. And in doing so, the real power of the work that Jesus calls us to is revealed. Several years ago, I remember reading an account by the great Catholic priest and teacher, Henry Nouwen. I'm sure some of you have read his writings. He's an extremely accomplished intellectual mind, one of the great spiritual voices of the 20th century. He taught for years at Princeton, Harvard, and Yale, a Jesuit priest who traveled extensively working with communities around the issues of theology and life together. And at a certain point, Nouwen writes, he began to find himself, he was living in Cambridge, he began to feel something was off. He needed to find a new space, a spiritual renewal, and he wasn't quite sure what that was. And he went on retreat. He went on a 1 month long retreat to a community in France called the L'Arche community. L'Arche is a community of people with disabilities and those who assist them. They live together in homes and apartments, sharing life, usually matched up, one with disabilities with one who does not. Everyone is welcomed. Everyone is believed to have the capacity to grow and to mature and to make contributions to this society, regardless of what the limitations are they may be living with. And having lived this incredibly intellectual life, Nouwen writes that he was terrified to receive their invitation to come and be pastor in their community for a year. He said, I felt completely unprepared and flat out afraid to go and do that work with them for a year that eventually turned into 10 years. He writes about his confusion, and yet he says it was a journey that would lead him to the heart of God. As this man of great status came and experienced the profound humility of living among people who had no knowledge of that or experience of that or any way to make sense of that. Choosing life in community and choosing Jesus, Nouwen writes, are increasingly appearing to me as two aspects of the same choice. And it is here, he says, that his deepest handicap emerged. Having led a life in which he lived in Jesuit houses or in seminaries or in university housing where he was cared for, he had never cleaned or cooked or taken care of another vulnerable human being. He writes that to be in relationship at L'Arche with others, so different from himself in this deep servant mode, it meant radical self-confrontation. Radical self-confrontation, he wrote. And he was very grateful for the patience and the support of the staff who had worked there for many years and who understood. He wrote particularly of a moment of praying with that community. One of their members had gone into the hospital, and the residents had organized a prayer service for her. He said the simplicity, directness, and intimacy of their prayer often makes me feel like a skeptical bystander. I even feel a certain jealousy for their special gift of prayer, but they do not want me to be jealous. They hugged and kissed me after our prayer. And Michael, the young man that he cared for, took him by the hand and led him to the sacristy to show Nouwen the red stole that Michael would like to start wearing. Letting go of his own self-centeredness became part of the healing that Nouwen found in the L'Arche community, a healing he didn't even know he needed. And it's part of the invitation that Jesus puts before us today. It turns out that to be great is to be focused on someone other than yourself, on something that matters enormously other than themselves. It turns out that greatness lies in welcoming the one who is not viewed as powerful by our culture, the one who is outside the circle, the one who craves a welcome. and friends. As we gather here today and contemplate a new year of life together, it is the call of the church. We who know, we who have been raised on these beautiful parables and stories that allow us space to wonder, we who have been given this incredible space to come into and feel comfortable and prayerful in, we need to know that those stories, that this place and this community should ground us and fill us and root us deeply and allow it to be rocket fuel, to push us into the world, to vision ministry that empowers the world around us. All around us, families are raising children in an uncertain time. People are aging alone, away from family and friends. All around us are people who are trying to reboot their lives that may not have gone as they expected. In everything Jesus does and says, there is challenge and there is invitation. And he often leaves the details to us. What does the kingdom of God look like? Today we know that it looks like a king who came to walk with the slowest, who came to walk with the weakest, who came humbly and without an impressive entourage, to call to us to follow him. It is the call of a servant king. Amen.
I invite you to stand and join me in reaffirming our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things are made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again. In accordance with the scriptures, he ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead, the life of the world to come. Amen. God of abundance, you open your hand and feed us in due season, satisfying the desires of every living thing. God of mercy, we pray for peace among the nations, food for the hungry, justice and equity for the poor, and a life of dignity for all people. God of mercy,
be gracious to us.
We pray for new life in the church, fresh energy and mission, fertile soil in which to spiritually grow, faithfulness and joy in ministry, and reconciliation as one body of Christ. God of mercy, Be gracious to us. We pray for the welfare of this community, safe streets and homes, good schools and jobs, and the spirit of love among neighbors. God of mercy, be gracious to us. We pray for the healing of all who suffer, comfort for the afflicted, hope for the despairing, and strength for those who care for them. We pray this day particularly for Margie Williams, Liz Zabritsky, Gay and Kayla Evans, Pat Vervena, Joe and Janet Bush, Ann Verber, the Fournier family, Jenny Brown, Mary and Hank Furness, Greta Sprague, Marion Hill, Ted Woodcock, Mary Jane Capriati, Susan, John Wells, Katie Alleman, Poet Mill, Tyson, Patrick, Carol and Don Ferguson, Barbara, Jenny Berg, Dorothy Henry, Joan Freer, Jim Foster, Beatrice, Joan Snyder, Virginia Clark, Priscilla Green, and L.B. Berg. And for Danny and Doug Budakes. God of mercy, be gracious to us. We give thanks for our ancestors, for our loved ones who have gone before us and who now rest with you. God of mercy, be gracious to us.
O God, in whom all things are possible, we commend these prayers to you and commit our lives to seek your will through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
Please stand as you're able. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Peace, you guys. Thank you.
My name is John Frost, and I am the rescue person of the week. I invite you at this time to fasten your seatbelts because we as St. Christopher have an amazing program, interesting and fun things that are going to happen in the next 6 weeks or so. And I'd just like to mention a few of them. Starting on Tuesday, there is a book group discussion at 2 o'clock online. The Book of Longings is the name of the text. Information in the bulletin on that. And then Tuesday night, we start our first adult education of this season. We'll be studying the Book of Mark at 7 o'clock Tuesday night, also online. A week from today, that next Sunday, we will begin the program called Sacred Ground, which is a thoughtful, contemplative prayer prayerful discussion of race in this country. It should be very interesting and stimulating going forward. Any people out there in Zoom land? And the church too. So then, moving forward, October 3rd would be blessing the animals right down here under the sign. This is something that we've done from time to time in St. Christopher's. It's always a flood event. Those of you who have been on the Holy Heights know you've met my dog every day. She will be there. Do not worry, do not fear, and have her shrunk and frozen. So, blessing with the animals has made your pets in safety. Every day will be a good dog. 2 weeks from then, the 15th to the 17th of October, will be Shrine Month. Time for 3 days of working with me for all reflection, discussion, relaxation, activities to reflect on the world. Always a church calendar. Coming back here the next Saturday, the 23rd of October, will be Tree Appreciation Day. And we'll have a number of events going on there, one of which is something called Forest Bathing. It's a process, a facilitated process where you travel 2 hours actually, you go out into the woods here. And we will open our hearts and minds to the majesty and grandeur of our forests. And say, I'm a powerful experience. I've never actually done it. I'm looking forward to it. There's a limited number of people who can participate in this. So if you're interested, please help me next day. I'll put you on the list. So then, moving forward, October 30th at 4 o'clock. This is a Saturday. Joe Walski will be doing something called Spooky Suzuki. Now, I didn't know Joe Walski worked like that, but apparently he does. And I can't imagine what he's going to do with Spooky Suzuki, but it should be fine. And then, listening to a more distant future, the best thing
last meeting on Tuesday, I was able to find some funding so that we're going to be able to bring the camel and several other animals back in December, which is always a fun event.
We'll try to make that as big and wonderful as we can. So, having taken you a ways into the future, I'd like to bring you back to the present and invite our senior warden, Mary Fran, to come up. Mary Fran will be speaking to us about another program that you used today, which is stewardship. Mary Fran.
Okay, thank you, Tom. Mics are something really cool. So, when I became senior board, I did something, or agreed to do something that I hadn't expected, and that was to be stewardship chairperson. So, we're starting this off this week, and tell me, who got an envelope from St. Christopher's in the mail today? Yay! I thought I was going to be the first one to turn it in, and it turned out at least Alice Mary has already turned hers in, so I can't be the first. But let's have a contest and see who can get them in. You can put them in the offering plate, you can hand them to Debbie Freer, you can just make sure we get them. So the reason we have stewardship pledge drives is so that the vestry, every year about this time, starts thinking and planning for the next year. We need to know what money we can count on, what funds we can count on, so that we can do all the things we want to do, the various programs, the various activities, the repairs. We need to be able to mow the yard, get rid of snow. Some of these things we used to do on our own. We used to have people clean out the gutters, and I think John has started doing that again. But some of these things we now pay for, and to pay for them, we have to have a budget so that we know we can pay for them. So we very much appreciate all the talent and the time that people are putting into this parish, but we also need the treasure. So in the words of a priest I once knew, and I mentioned it in my recent meeting, if you want to know how much to give to the parish, how much to pledge, give it all, brother, give it all. But if you can't give it all, give generously, but give, and we very much appreciate this.
So I shared with the 8 o'clock group that not that there's any competition between clergy, but I have a good friend who is on St. Francis Day blessing the D.C. Police forces. And he sent me a text.
Very proudly said, guess who I get to bless? So I was very excited to send back a text and say, I get to bless a camel. Sorry. It'll be an Advent, but I can bless a camel in Advent. So I'm grateful that we'll be able to fund that wonderful project again. Again, that's something that we can put out to families all over the community, and people can come and be part of Jesus's story in that way, and start to encounter it, start to bump into it, start to experience it. So it's powerful, and I'm grateful for all those who've worked to make that happen. Thank you very much. And we would like to say together, we have a stewardship prayer, I think we're okay, that Mary Fran and I would like to lead you in this morning. So the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Almighty God, we thank you for all the gifts you have given us, our lives, our loved ones, all that we have, and all that we are. Most of all, we thank you for Jesus, your Son, and our Redeemer, who came among us to show us the way to eternal life. Jesus was a perfect steward of your gifts, showing that your complete trust in you is necessary, and that giving of self is the most important part of following him. May the offerings of our time, our talents, and our material resources be made in the same spirit of sacrifice that Jesus taught us by his life and death for us. Amen. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Do we have any birthdays this morning? Have any birthdays online that we need to bless? No birthdays, no anniversaries. We are usually, and please, I appreciate that you continue to keep Danny and Doug in your prayers as they navigate waiting for a new one, new little person to arrive. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself as a sacrifice and offering to God. That's right. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
God of all power, ruler of the universe, you are worthy of glory and praise. At your command, all things came to be. The vast expanse of interstellar space, galaxies, suns, and planets in their courses, and this fragile earth, our island home.
By your will, they were created and have their being.
From the primal elements, you brought forth the human race and blessed us with memory, reason, and skill. You made us the rulers of creation, but we turned against you and betrayed your trust, and we turned against one another.
Have mercy, Lord, for we are sinners in your sight.
Again and again, you called us to return. Through the prophets, sages, you revealed your righteous law, and in the fullness of time, you sent your son, born of a woman, to fulfill your law, to open for us the way of freedom and peace.
By his blood, he reconciled us. By his wounds, we are healed.
And therefore, we praise you, joining with the heavenly chorus, with prophets, apostles, and martyrs, and with all those in every generation who have looked to you in hope, to proclaim with them your glory in their unending hymn, Holy, Holy, Holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. And so, Father, we who have been redeemed by him and made a new people by water and the Spirit, now bring before you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit, to be the body and blood of Jesus Christ, our Lord. On the night before he died, he took bread, said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his friends and said, take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for remembrance of me. After supper, he took the cup of wine, gave thanks, and said, drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me. Remembering now his work of redemption and offering to you this sacrifice of thanksgiving,
we celebrate his death and resurrection as we await the day of his coming.
Lord God of our fathers and mothers, God of Abraham and Sarah, Isaac and Rebecca, Jacob, Rachel and Leah, God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, open our eyes to see your hand at work in the world about us. Deliver us from the presumption of coming to this table for solace only and not for strength, for pardon only and not for renewal. Let the grace of this Holy Communion make us one body, one spirit in Christ, that we may worthily serve the world in his name.
Risen Lord, be known to us in the breaking of the bread.
Accept these prayers, Father, through Jesus Christ, our great high priest, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit, your church gives honor, glory, and worship from generation to generation.
Amen. Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast.
For the people of God.
Let us break bread together on our knees. Let us break bread together.
Let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart through Christ our Lord. Amen. Now may the faithful love of the Creator, the healing presence of Christ, the life-giving power of the Spirit attend you this day and evermore. Amen. Let us go forth into the world rejoicing in the power of the Spirit.
Thanks be to God.